It makes you feel. There's a little indigestion at the top. Everyone's been eating. Sorry, guys. That was a run. That was a run. Can we bring it down a little bit? You know the Jazz Cafe food's good too. So we're gonna just do that one more time. Here, go. Up top. It makes you. Sorry. Does it really? When the love is real, it makes you feel. Yeah, it makes you feel.
How did you begin with your interest for music?
It's an interesting question for me. Music, to be honest, my introduction to music in my life has really been as a way to know yourself. So I'm raised more so on roots, revival, Pan-African messages, self-awareness messages. I used to think Bob Marley was singing to me in a tune, Natty Dread, because everyone called me Natty Dread when I was little. Learning about self, army family, so we're traveling around, but the one thing that remained constant was the fact that we're of Jamaican descent, and this music was teaching us about ourselves. Then you go a bit further in, and music is a bit of identity again. It's cooler as you're getting older, you're starting to get into what you're into and stuff like that. I shared a room with my sister who's 5 years older than me. So what she was into, I was into Luther Vandross. But I've always kind of been close. My brother had a sound system, so I was very close in that way. The sound system most time was set up in the garage at the back of the house, so it was what we did. Then I had a singing group that started in the art class, just sitting down, enjoying harmonies. I love to collaborate. I love harmony. I love the unity that is created and things like that. This is all while studying at a performing arts school. And then later I actually find my love, my passion, which is performance poetry. I'd been a writer. This is what I first claimed that I am. Loved theatre, but not really too excited about the Eurocentric, patriarchal, misogynistic roles that are available. Was looking forward to writing my plays. I still do so now. But performance poetry really just was a mixture of everything I love and allowed me to share my own voice. So this journeys me into flowetry, which is a creation of poetic delivery, musical intent. Again, I'm not really looking to get into the music world. I'm just a mixed medium artist, I suppose. So the music has always kind of been tugging me and allowing me in, which has been interesting. So my baptism into music has been one that didn't come from trying to go into music. It came from studying my craft and being more of a multimedia performance artist.
You just slid that way.
Yeah, literally, literally.
When you first started with him, what was your first impression? Was it a little bit like, maybe this can work, or I'll just give it a chance? What was your attitude towards?
Being in the music industry, I thought was a countdown to when somebody realizes that, they let me in the back door. that was what it felt like to me. It was never something that I was just trying to be in forever. There are a lot of things that I want to do, a lot of things in theatre, a lot of things in literature that I want to do. I was never really just trying to be a recording artist, although I absolutely adore performing live music. It's such a joy. So when I first kind of came into the music industry, it was quite funny for me because I knew all the things that I stand for and things that mean the making of me as a person and the growing that I was doing. Funnily enough, the journey was actually very enjoyable. The challenging aspect is the people, not so much the buildings that you go into to sign documents. And I happened to, poetry was signed in a very up scale turn for the industry. Creatively, they were signing, neo soul was a real thing, and boom, boom, boom. Yeah. So timing wise, it was right. it took a couple of years for that to start to shift and change. Neo-soul, there's very few artists of the neo-soul movement who claim neo-soul now. You know, they're all R&B artists now, and I suppose wanted different things. For me, what was interesting is I love the lane. I love the lane, I love the spirit of it, I love the energy of it, the passion of it. At first I didn't really like another title being put on my head because I was happy with saying that what I did was Flowetry. But I appreciated the lane after a while. So the experience of the music industry wasn't too bad. It was, and I think the reason it wasn't too bad is because it's everything I kind of expected, good, bad and indifferent. All of it I kind of...
experienced.
Yeah, I expected it. I expected it to happen. I expected for at some point for me to be a bit too much for the people that I was around. I expected that. I expected at some point that Flowetry would come to an end. I knew Marsha would leave. I knew that in the beginning. I expected things would change. In terms of the energy of the neo-soul movement, I expected that. I expected the cycles to shift. That doesn't mean that I was just ready for everything. I expected all of it, but then, you know, you experience it. And then when you experience it, you've got to swallow a couple, grow up, you know? But it's all been quite positive, especially in hindsight. With the use of hindsight, it's all been positive, yeah.
But as a beautiful woman as you are, didn't you expect certain other things to come into place as well? I mean, everything's about how you look nowadays.
Yeah, it is. It's
a real particular look.
Well, you know, you definitely start to realise when you're like the only person with natural hair in the room, you know, that those things are definite. You know, it's weave galore right now, it's plastic surgery, it's bleaching, it's all the things that I'm not, hence the reason I knew there would be a timeline until everyone realizes, like, how does she get in here though? That one. But that being said, there really is such true large markets for everything and everybody. There's a lane for everybody, you know? Everything's a spiritual journey for me. I'm not really a career chaser like that. I'm really looking to develop as a being and to remember myself ancestrally. So,
that's where your focus is.
That's where my focus is. So, as things are changing and shifting, it's funny because I think image-wise, it saved me for a while. Image. I think for a time in Flowetry, that was something that was going on. With the majors who just deal with
Find out how to cope with you, even your image-wise, because they don't know much about that. You know, they have a few dreadlock guys themselves, very high level, but, you know, to really have a true, somebody who really comes from that, that's unusual for them.
Oh, absolutely. You know, it was always fun telling them that I needed a natural hairstylist for shoots, and they would have people who would turn up with, for me, with combs and tongs, you know. When we cast the children on the front of the Flowetic album cover, you know, and I specifically said I wanted children with natural hair, there was about four at the casting, you know, all the children's hair had been processed and stuff like that. So it's really difficult because, especially in this day and age where to say natural hair nowadays, people think that you're natural if you have a perm but you don't have weave, which is really intriguing. That's something I had to learn. Meeting people who put wigs on over their locks, very deep for me when I first saw that. And you know, the attack, and it's on everyone right now. You know, you have Caucasian people attempting to look more African, and you have African people trying to look more Caucasian. It's everywhere. Yeah. It's a really intriguing time. And then you've got everybody trying to look like their airbrush picture as well. You know,
that's trading places, basically, that's what's going on.
Man, it really is. It really is. A lot of trading places going on. The things that one side are getting rid of, the other side are paying money for to get, you know, it's really out there. So, that's interesting.
Somebody would pick up my garbage.
I tell you, it's interesting, but, you know, little things. The more I process as well, I mean, I'm 35 now, so I'm very in my seat, and I feel very comfortable with myself. I don't, every show I don't have makeup on. I don't mind makeup, but I really use it barely. So sometimes, you know, I'll turn up for, the other day I turned up for a radio interview at One Extra, and I could just, I just knew that the two guys, the security guys, they're looking at me and they're immediately, their judgment immediately is she's not an artist.
Yeah.
Because I don't,
she used to be in handcuffs.
I don't have on, you know, a face of makeup at 8 o'clock in the morning. I don't have an entourage, you know, it's right. Me and my brothers rolled up there. I'm just chilling. So I'm aware of that quite often. I call it my invisibility cloak. Mm. It allows me to just kind of flow. But again, I'm a poet. I was never trying to be a recording artist. I was never trying to get away from myself in that type of way. You know, I'm not running away, I'm not trying to recreate myself. If anything, I'm remembering myself and becoming more myself.
Rebuilding,
trying to get back to that 7-year-old. Mm. She was post-program, you know, she was who she is and quite happy about that, yeah. And ancient, and she remembered a lot of things, and she was, so getting back to that, really.
It's probably the best thing to concentrate your energies on. The other stuff could be a waste of time. Could be.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Yeah. Works for some.
Works for some. Yeah. And I'm really only speaking for myself here. This isn't a judgment, a projection. This is really just what works for me. Like, say for instance, sometimes people will say to me, you know, where have you been?
Yeah.
But I've put out 3 albums since poetry. Came to an end since Marsha left, should I say.
They need to connect with you on Twitter, don't they?
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah, on Twitter, I'm there, Instagram, I'm there, Facebook, I'm there. But I'm not taking pictures of the cup of tea before I drink it. No. You know, I'm not.
Right.
I interact, I share. Yeah. I share from a very honest place. Mm. Like, this is really what I was thinking, what I was feeling, and Spirit said to share it. Mm. But at the same time, I'm not into the consumerization aspect of artistry. Of course, I make a living through my craft, absolutely. But I'm not trying to trick anybody. I'm not trying to figure out how to trick somebody into buying something. And I believe as an artist, and as a life artist, a lifetime artist, you have to live as well.
I don't know about you, but that made me feel good. Because the love was real.